So, a very good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome Dr. Shanmuganathan, sir, a well-known pediatrician who is the president of Vilippuram Pondi IAP branch, who is the chairperson for this session. And we will be starting with the topic Fluid Therapy in Peace and War. And the speaker is Dr. Lenin Muthukumar Ramamurthy. He's a well-known pediatric practitioner who has 4 years of PICU experience in tertiary care medical college hospital. He's the assistant professor of pediatrics in Madurai Medical College, and he's graduated from ESI Chennai. So I welcome you, sir.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us in this fine morning. Today, we are pleased to welcome Dr. Lenin Muthukumar Ramamurthy. He is from Madurai Medical College. He is a well-known person in the Madurai Medical College. And now he is going to share his opinion and views with us on the fluid management. With that, I will ask for full attention to Dr. Lenin and help me to welcoming him to the stage. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I like to thank the organizing committee, Pudumai Pedikan 2021, for giving me this opportunity. So my topic is fluid therapy in peace, which is maintenance fluids and war situations, like special situations. I would like to start with the quote, all things are poisons and nothing is without poison. Only the dose permits something not to be poisonous. This thing is applicable to all the things in our life, like food, drugs, Zoom meetings, hand sanitizers, etc. When coming to the fluids, it's all the more important because too much fluid is also problematic and too low fluid is also problematic. So what are the indications of fluid therapy in children? It is used for resuscitation of shock and while prescribing the maintenance fluids and replacement of excessive losses from the stomas, NG tubes, and drains. And it is also useful for the nutritional support. Most of the times, we are using the combination of any one of the above indications. So it is the right time to consider fluid as the 4Ds. It should be considered as the drug. And it should be, while prescribing the fluids, we have to consider the clinical condition of the patients, electrolyte status, cardiac status, and acid base status. It should be chosen the right fluid and dosing should be appropriate. And we have to know when to start, how to escalate, and if needed, we have to de-escalate the fluid for the patient's requirement. So the goal of maintenance therapy is to prevent the dehydration and electrolyte disorders and prevent the ketoacidosis and prevent the protein degradation from the prolonged starving. The main components of the fluid therapies are water, dextrose, and electrolytes like sodium and potassium. Usually the chloride is the accompanying anion. Sometimes the patient needs bicarbonate, acetate, and lactate. So maintenance therapy basically replaces the ongoing daily losses of water and electrolytes occurring via physiological process like respiration, temperature control, and the minimal solute excretion via the kidneys. So 1957, Holiday Seeger proposed the maintenance fluids based on the caloric expenditure based on the weight. And he proposed the sodium requirement of 3 milliequivalents, potassium of 2, and chloride of 2 milliequivalents per 100 kilocalories per day. The suggested fluid is usually hypotonic. So basically, other methods are also there to calculate the maintenance fluids like body surface area method and basal caloric metric method. But for all the practical purpose, the main thing is in maintenance of the calculation of fluid is based on caloric expenditure and total body weight. Approximately 100 ml of exogenous water are needed to replace the insensible and sensible losses for every 100 kilocalorie per kg of energy expenditure. So insensible water loss is around 45 ml, along 36 skin 30 ml and lungs are 15 ml. But sensible water loss is from the renal losses and sweat and stool. Here, the sweat and stool is negligible. So sensible water loss usually measures the renal loss. So this is the method to calculate the maintenance fluids for first 10 kg, 100 ml per kg per day. If we are calculated for the hourly rates, it is a 4 ml per kg per hour. If the weight is between 11 to 20 kg, along with 1000 ml, 50 ml per kg for each kg is more than 10 kg. For the hourly rate, 40 ml per hour plus 2 ml per kg per hour for each 10 kg, each kg is more than 10 kg. The weight is more than 20 kg, 1500 ml plus 20 ml per kg for each kg more than 20 kg. In the hourly rate, 60 ml per hour plus 1 ml per kg for more than 20 kg. The maximum fluid rate is 2400 ml per day or 100 ml per hour. While calculating with above method, in case of obesity, it is overestimate the water needs of the overweight children. In that case, we have to calculate the maintenance fluid based on the ideal body weight, which is 15th percentile of body weight for the child's height. So what is the choice of fluid, whether it is hypotonic or isotonic? Since 57, the Holiday Seeger proposed, we are using the hypotonic fluid. But for the past two decades, there is a concern raised about the hyponatremia induced complication and mortality and morbidity in the critically ill children. So while reviewing the systematic review of all the literatures comparing the hypotonic versus isotonic solution, there is a clear cut indications. There is a potential harm of hypotonic solution in children, which can be avoided while using the isotonic or near isotonic solutions, which is more physiological, so it is more safer. American Academy of Pediatrics also endorses the same and issues the key action statement, that is, patients 28 days to 18 years of age requiring maintenance IV fluid should receive isotonic solutions with appropriate dextrose and KCM, because it significantly decreases the risk of hyponatremia and it has the strong evidence. So this recommendation is applicable for surgical and medical patients in critical care settings and also in general inpatient ward. If the child is having the other comorbid conditions like neurological, cardiac and hepatic diseases and renal dysfunction, diabetes insipidus, this is not applicable, and it is not applicable for neonates less than 28 days of life and more than 18 years of age. Well, coming to the composition of the IV fluids, what are the isotonic fluids we have? Isotonic fluids are considered if the fluid's osmolarity is equal to the plasma osmolarity, it is considered as the isotonic fluids. So normal saline, Ringer lactate, D5 normal saline, D5 Ringer lactate and plasma lactate, all them. So all the fluids have the osmolarity similar to the plasma. So these are considered as the osmolarity. Isotonic saline and hypotonic salines are isolate P, half NS and 0.2% NaCl. What is balanced crystallites? Usually in normal saline, the chloride level is slightly higher than the physiological range. In balanced crystallites, the chloride level is equal to the human plasma. So it is considered as the balanced crystallites. Nowadays, the balanced crystallite is gaining momentum during the resuscitation, especially if we are using higher amounts of fluids. So apart from the normal maintenance, in what are the conditions, there is an increased water needs apart from maintenance fluids. In preterm birth, fever, burns, gastrointestinal illness like vomiting and diarrhea, sweat because of the excessive exercise, polyuria, tracheostomy and surgical drains needs more waters, and decreased water needs if the child is ventilated with humidified oxygen and the volume overloaded conditions, oliguric or anuric conditions, the preterm is nursed in incubator, there is a decreased water needs. So while coming to the war situations like shock, the fluid of choice is isotonic crystallite infusions, normal saline or RL. But the balanced crystallite solution is nowadays gaining momentum because it avoids the hyperchloremic acidosis induced AKA and related morbidity and mortality. So while giving the fluid boluses, the time duration is so important. While treating the compensated hypovolemic shock, 10 to 20 ml per kg of normal saline over 5 to 20 minutes. And after the each bolus, we have to monitor for the hemodynamic improvement by the tissue perfusions, urine output, pulse volume, and capillary refilling time. And at the same time, we have to monitor for the fluid overloaded signs like new onset Krebs, hepatomegaly, and pink froths like that. In case of hypotensive hypovolemic shock, 20 ml per kg over the 5 to 10 minutes is needed. If needed, we have to go for the another boluses. But the time duration, whether we can give within the stipulated time period, is again debatable. In case of cardiogenic shock, the lower fluid volume with longer duration is recommended, based 5 to 10 ml per kg over 15 to 30 minutes. Septic survival campaigns endorsed the 40 to 60 ml of 60 ml per kg of fluid in the first hour as the bolus of 10 to 20 ml per kg per bolus. But it has to be given if the intensive care monitoring is there. The same survival campaigns endorses only 40 ml per kg of bolus if the resource limited setting, if the child is presenting with hypotension. The child is presenting without hypotension in the limited resources setting, the bolus is not recommended. So point of care ultrasound is very handy tool to provide the fluid boluses. It assesses the fluid responsiveness. There are some tools which is useful to assess the fluid responsiveness, plus passive lacrimizing test and end expiratory occlusions while the child is ventilated. So yearly aggressive and late conservative therapy gives the most benefits to the patients. So I could not elaborate the dengue shock management within the stimulated time period. So I would like to add the few points regarding the dengue shock. The first choice during this shock is crystallites. It should be given 10 ml per kg over 1 hour for first 1 or 2 hours. And for further fluids are based on the hematocrit value and bleeding tendencies. So we can go for the up to 40 ml per kg, 30 ml per kg. And there is a role for colloids in the dengue shock. 10% dextran in 40 is usually advised, and hydroxyethyl starches are not recommended. In case of bleeding manifestation, fresh whole blood is recommended rather than the PRBC. Suppose the child is in the fluid overloaded state, PRBC can be given. As per WHO guidelines, escalation or de-escalation of fluid is 7 ml per kg per hour, 5 ml per kg per hour, 3 ml per kg per hour, and 1.5 ml per kg per hour, vice versa, whether we to escalate or de-escalate. So what are the conditions? Restrictive fluid resuscitation is warranted. In child with severe acute malnutrition, it overestimates the degree of dehydration. Already the child have water retention and myocardial dysfunction. Though WHO recommends 10 to 15 ml of per kg of body weight over first hour. If needed, we can go for second doses. The fluid of choice is D5RL. In case of severe anemia presenting with shock, if the hemoglobin is less than 5, we can give 10 ml per kg of PRBC slowly over the 3 hours. The critically ill children of post-operative immobilized children, central nervous system infections and pulmonary diseases, pain, stress, anxiety are more prone for inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone. So in that case, the choice of fluid is isotonic fluid. Usually 50 to 80% of the routine maintenance is recommended. While calculating the fluid for burns in the first 24 hours of life, the modified Parkland formula is used. It is 4 ml per kg per total burn surface area. The burn surface area should be calculated for only second and third degree burns, not the first degree burns, along with the normal 24 hours maintenance fluid. Another method is Galveston's method, which is 5 liter per meter square per body burn surface area, along with 2000 ml per meter square for maintenance requirements. Half of the fluid should be given over the 8 hours. The remaining half should be given over the next 24 hours. The fluid of choice is Ringer lactate. If needed, if the child is less than 5 years or less than 20 kg, we can add the dextrose solutions. To prevent the excessive fluids in the first 24 hours in burns cases, they are trying with colloids, hypertonic saline and vitamin C, high doses of vitamin C, but all that is still in the study, in the research method only. It needs further studies to prove and benefit. In case of DKA, dehydration should be based on the pH, not based on the clinical assessment. For mild DKA, if it is less than 7.35%, less than 7.2 to 7.37%, less than 7.1, it is 10%. The fluid of choice is 0.45% or 0.9%, that is normal NS with 40 milliequivalents of KCl. There is a recent changes in the BISPET guidelines regarding DKA management. There is a separate lecture is done there. And another point is hypovolemic shock is very rare in DKA. And if it is present, we have to treat with 10 to 20 ml per kg of normal saline. If shock is not there and if the clinicians feel that the fluid can be benefited for the hyperglycemia, it should be given 10 ml per kg over 1 hour. At the end of the 1 hour, we have to start the insulin. And the bolus given for no shock patients has to be reduced from the fluid deficit plus maintenance over the 24 to 48 hours. And the shock boluses need not to be reduced. In case of tumor lysis syndrome, the 2018 International Expert Panel recommend the isotonic normal saline at the rate of 2 to 3 liter per meter square per day of IV fluids. And we are expecting the urine output of 80 to 100 ml per meter square per hour. And to look for the volume overloaded status, and if needed, it has to be used with diuretics to augment the urine output. If the child is already treated with steroids and has hypertension or sodium retention, we have to use for 5% exone with 1:4 normal saline to prevent the renal shutdown. In case of pyloric stenosis, 60% of the patients are presenting with normal electrolytes values with no DGTs. In that case, only the maintenance intravenous fluid is alone is enough. And the fluid of choice is 5% dextrose with 1/2 normal saline and 10 to 20 milliequivalents of KCl. In case of moderate to severe dehydration, the higher NaCl concentration is needed, and it is a normal saline with 1.5 to 2 times of the maintenance is recommended for pyloric stenosis. In case of solid state poisoning, only the alkalinization of urine is augmenting the excretion of the acids. 5% dextrose with soda bicarbonate with potassium is the fluid of choice. How to prefer 150 milliequivalents of soda bicarbonate into the 1 liter of 5% dextrose along with 20 to 40 milliequivalent KCl. It has to be given 1.5 to 2 times of the maintenance. The goal of the therapy is to achieve the urine output, urine pH of more than 7.5, and the serum pH should not be more than 7.58. Suppose the initial state of salicylic acid, if there is a metabolic respiratory alkalosis, there is no contraindications to start the bicarbonate solutions. And forced diuresis should not be performed, and acetylsalicylamide is also should not be performed to alkalinize the urine. So in case of replacement fluid, fluid deficit can be calculated by percentage of the dehydration into patient's weight. The intravascular volume, the shock should be treated with normal saline, and maintenance and deficit fluid should be given with DNS with 20%, 20 milliequivalents of KCl. Once the urine output is established, KCl should be added. So while coming to the replacement fluid, usually it has to be matched with the component and electrolytes component of the lost fluid. In case of diarrhea, it is high in potassium, loss is high. So in that case, D5 normal saline with 30 milliequivalent of soda bicarb and 20 milliequivalent of KCl should be replaced ml per ml for 1 to 6 hours. In case of vomiting, it is high chloride is lost. The solution of choice is normal saline with 10 milliequivalent of KCl. Replace the output ml per ml. The child is oliguria. We have to give the maintenance fluid of insensible water loss with D5 half NS and replace the urine output with ml per ml with D half NS plus or minus KCl, depending upon the serum KCl, patient's KCl, serum KCl state. In case of polyuria, replacement of the insensible fluid losses with the D5 half NS plus or minus KCl. And urine electrolyte should be measured, and the replacement fluid is the closest to the urinary electrolytes value. So the take-home message is, consider fluid as a drug. Isotonic fluids are the choice for maintenance fluid, DNS with KCl in our setup. Balanced crystallites gaining the momentum in resuscitative phase to avoid the hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis induced AKI. The role of colloids in resuscitative phase is still debatable. There are adult studies which have some benefits, but it cannot be recommended as a general standard of care. Especially in fluid therapy, one size does not fit all. We need the periodic evaluation of the fluid boluses and electrolytes monitoring for at least every 12 hours in our setups. Dose has to be escalated and de-escalated. Especially in the late phases, the dose should be de-escalated for benefit of the patients. The periodic clinical assessment and electrolytes and urine output and daily weight monitoring is important. Thank you.
Excellent talk by Dr. Muthukumar. Thank you, sir. Any other questions?